Welcome to the Leaderonomics show. I'm with Bibop, Gresta, CEO of Hyperloop. Bibop, welcome to the show and glad you're enjoying our Lego.
Yeah, I was impressed that you have Legos in here.
Oh, we have Lego
because
everywhere.
It reminds me of my childhood. I was actually building an Hyperloop pylon and I need some seismic isolators here.
Okay.
And I was enjoying this so much. So you can continue the show. I will be just
Unfortunately, we need to talk to you during the show. So
oh, you already talked to me. Okay, so
We'll talk a little bit and then we'll go talk about Hyperloop.
I was enjoying this, but anyway.
You know, you were talking about when you were young, you know, and that you know, you started very early in life, you know, 15.
Yeah, I think last
you were,
year.
Last year, right? That was when you were...
When I was 15.
You're 16 now, right?
Right.
So when you were 15, which was last year,
yeah.
You started out as a software engineer. How did that happen? I mean, how did someone so young suddenly get thrown into this world of technology?
So my father said to me, do whatever you want, you know, like you're the child of your age,
right.
Use drug, do whatever you want.
But sounds like a cool father, right?
But don't touch my computer and my keyboard.
Oh, so that was... okay.
And I became a programmer and musician.
Because he said don't touch it, right?
Yes.
So whatever you ban is where the kids will...
Yeah, he was sealing the keyboard and the computer in his in the room on top floor of his house.
Okay.
And I was doing whatever it was possible to actually sneak out, taking a ladder and jump in a little door to actually enter and play with it.
Okay.
By the time I was 12, I started when I was probably 8, and then when I was 12, I already knew more than, of computer than him. So we decided to do a deal. I was teaching him how to use it, and he was paying me to study it. And he sent me to IBM. I did a course, and I passed with the maximum of the score. So the IBM sent me to a company, multinational company, actually to work for them as a chief engineer. And I was 12. I wasn't chief at 12. I became the chief of engineer at 15.
Okay. Well, so you started at 12 then?
Yeah.
With IBM. Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it was a multinational company. It was called Alpha Center International. They were doing complex software to hyperlearn. And it was fascinating, but I was not inventing anything. I was just programming computer. For me, it was natural.
But then somehow that led to a music sort of career, right?
How
did that happen?
Funny enough, they sent me to study, the multinational company sent me to study in America, and they sent me to Los Angeles, but they thought it was Los Angeles. It was San Bernardino. It was like the ghetto.
Similar. LA, San Bernardino.
Yeah, the problem was that in that city, there was a lot of different university. They sent me in the worst one. So I became interested in rap and hip hop and dancing. So I learned English, but it was, yo, man, what's up? Was a kind of a weird English.
Okay.
But I get in love with music. So when I came back, with the money I was doing with the multinational company, I created my own studio and I started to do my own recording. And then one day I was doing during my birthday, I was doing a sort of show for my friends. And a famous DJ was in the club doing a show after the party. And he saw my performance and he said, I want to produce you. So all of a sudden, I did a record that went first in the chart. And it started my career of musician. And all of a sudden, I was doing a tour of 60 cities around Italy.
In Italy, wow.
Italy, Switzerland, Germany, Austria. We touched a lot of... Apparently, that song went
viral.
Viral, and it was the 90s.
Wow.
Dance music. You don't want to hear that song.
Maybe we should get you to sing after this. Were you singing or were you...
I was rapping.
You was rapping? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So we got to get you at the last segment to do a little bit of that.
To rekindle
the past, you know. It's always nice.
Okay.
Okay, so we'll do that. But then how did the transition go? You know, you went back into setting up Bibop, right?
So that time was useful because I learned a lot about show business. They offered me a job as a first as a singer. Then in TV, I had my own show that was called Austin with one that became one of my best friends. And we were talking about video games. And then MTV called, and we basically created the most successful show in Italy. Sushi, Sashimi, Toku Show, Kitchen, Bradipo, Tiziana. These are all shows.
I love the very famous intersection between Japanese and Italian.
They were actually almost all talk shows about crazy stuff or, you know. But then they realized I was a knowledgeable technical guy that was also a showman, right? And when at that moment Telecom Italia needed a spokesperson, they called me. Telecom Italia is the biggest telco in Italy, 80% of the market at that time. And they asked me to create a community project when, you know, we're talking about probably 10 BF, 10 before Facebook.
Yep. BF.
So,
or BG, right?
10, probably 11 BG.
No, maybe
15 BG. 15 BG. So that's it's the ancient moment of the internet. We're talking about, you know, Itapak at that moment, not even internet. But the project was so successful, it's called Alice, that did 3.5 million users in the first year. So Telecom Italia came back to me in 1998 and offered an outrageous amount of money to buy my company.
Wow. Is that how your nickname Bibop came about, or?
But the company Bibop came after my name, and it became very quickly a company of 300 engineers developing the most interesting and successful internet projects. Also events, concerts, we were doing everything.
And so you sold that off completely?
I sold it 40% at the beginning and then completely to another group. And I started with that money.
Started Digital Magics?
I started Digital Magics.
And what's Digital Magics? Tell us a bit about it.
It's still a very successful company. I basically quit 3 years ago before starting Hyperloop. And it's an investment company. I invested in 70 companies. In 2012, it represented 20% of the total Italian innovation market, not because I'm cool, but because the innovation market in Italy doesn't exist. So,
but that's like almost like a venture cap sort of.
It was an incubator equity, early stage startups.
Okay.
So we were the first in Italy to create something like that. Nothing was really happening before us, and we also promoted the entire sector of startups. We invented the juridical definition of startup and innovative incubator that became the base for a law that we made pass to in the government that for the first time in Italy incentivized tax exemptions and so on. Tax are terrible in Italy, 60% of taxes.
Okay, you should move to Malaysia.
Right. Well, we're looking at this area, Singapore, Malaysia, you know, because of that. But that was the beginning of the startup, the new economy in Italy.
Okay, so we're just out of time, so we're going to take a quick break. We're going to come back and we're going to zoom a little bit more deeper into Digital Magics and find out a little bit more into how you became who you became.
We're here
on the Leaderonomics Show with Bibop. Welcome to the Leaderonomics Show. I'm with Bibop Gresta, who was also a founder of Digital Magics. And we were talking about Digital Magics and Bibop and being a software engineer at 15. I mean, what motivates you? Not many kids or not many young adults have the drive to want to create, put a dent in the universe, to want to make a difference, right?
So to me, the magic of programming was being capable of being in control of the machines was magic. When I was designing the first sprites, and then I was sprites. You're too young to know that.
I'm too young. Yeah.
It was a way to design drawing that then you can animate it by moving the bytes inside the figure.
Okay.
And there was a very complicated way to do it, but for me it was magic seeing that I could write something in a computer and that will result in magic thing happening, right? That was the first motivation. And then science. I've always been fan of, you know, discoveries in science. I was going to this astronomy lab. I was lucky because in my city there was one. So I was following all these cycles of conferences about space and about how you can, you know, humanity will progress with right. that. It was
so that inspired you, and yes. even with digital magics, is to invest in companies that push science. Is it?
They push innovation, science. It was a lot about disruptive technologies and innovation, innovative technologies. So that was
so. Speaking of disruptive technologies, Hyperloop, right? It's your latest baby.
Yes.
Tell us a bit about. You know, it's a concept, it's an idea. I guess it's starting to take root.
So when Elon Musk published the white paper, he didn't invent anything. He basically drafted and put a giant spotlight in an idea that was old in almost 100 years. In the 18th century, the first Hyperloop was conceived, similar to an Hyperloop. 1870, under the New York subway, there was the first prototype built by Eli Beach, a wow. very courageous entrepreneur. They built almost 800 meter between Warren and Broadway of a real pneumatic tube train that was actually working. We sent people there to find the place, and we found the piano that was played in the first class. It was a very short journey, but that was so brilliant that started basically the New York Underground. Now, that project failed because of technology issues and also because there was the big crisis coming. Mm-hmm. But several times in the year of its evolution, humanity attempted to create an Hyperloop. 1904, Robert Goddard patented the solution. 1969, the American government published four different projects. One was called Gravity Vacuum, and the other one was Two Flight. And that was basically the Hyperloop. The only thing missing was how to propel and levitate the capsule in an efficient way.
Yeah.
So when Elon published the white paper, it was already there, but he pointed out there's this possibility, and now we have the technology to do it. My business partner, Dirk Alborn, a genius entrepreneur.
So we got to get him on the show.
I will suggest him to come. And took the idea and published it into its Jumpstart Found website. At that time, I wasn't in the company. But he did it in a very amazing way. He didn't not went around to seek from VCs. He just called Elon and said, you know, can I do it? And then he published it into the website, doing a giant call to action. And what happened after is magic. 100 scientists from different countries started to pitch ideas on how to make it happen. In reality, they...
So it's really crowdsourcing for ideas.
It was...
To some extent.
Yes, it was crowdsourcing for ideas. And the basic idea behind it is we will give you stock options in exchange of your time and your mind. When I met Dirk, they were already working on the initial white paper of Elon Musk, because we immediately realized it wasn't doable. But when I met my business partner, he pitched me the idea and I said, what? So you want to do the Hyperloop without raising any penny using crowdsourcing?
Sure.
I was completely not, you know, convinced of the possibility. And then he sent me a document showing the work that these scientists did already, piece by piece, and all the evolution and also the different solution and the problem that they found on the previous attempt mm-hmm. to build the Hyperloop. And there was, point by point, a solution for every single problem that we will be facing to build it. And then I was, after 2 months of research, and then I started also to call these people because I wasn't believing it. They were people from NASA, Tesla, SpaceX, Boeing, Aerospace, MIT, Stanford.
It's everywhere.
All together working in a project in exchange of stock options without taking money. What are we talking about? It's craziness, right? It was true. And to me, there was something that was even bigger than the Hyperloop. There was the first attempt that humanity has created to bring together the best minds of this planet to solve a problem.
Yep.
This is amazing. Imagine to apply this to everything.
Yeah, to any problem, right?
To energy consumption, to energy production, to food consumption, to housing. We can solve all the problem of humanity using this. It's just a matter of stopping, continuing this craziness about this economy of consumption that we have.
And why do you think it worked? I mean, what was the magic secret sauce? Or that, I mean, a lot of people try, you know, to do something similar, but they're not so successful as you guys have been.
It worked because it was the right moment, it was the right idea, and it inspired people. Imagine to create a system that is actually not only fast, but is also efficient. We can produce 30% more electricity than we consume, and we can be completely clean. We use renewable energy, and it's not about just going fast. It's to bring people closer in a better way, recouping the joy of travel. That's the goal, yeah. And that's what we are doing right now.
So tell us a bit about Hyperloop. I mean, if you can, in 30 seconds or a minute, I mean, if you need to use the Lego, go ahead. What exactly is the Hyperloop for our audience to truly understand?
The Lego, it's a good thing. I didn't know you were having the Lego here, because Lego actually inspired us to actually build the company in the way we built it. I don't know, and not a lot of people knows that Lego was one of the first companies that used crowdsourcing. And actually, they saved the company, because from market leader, they were actually bankrupt. They were almost gone. But all of a sudden, they started to listen to their people and say, what do we do wrong? We don't understand. It's such a great product, and nobody wants to buy it anymore. Guess what? The kids changed. They are not the same kids that we were. So they need to speak a different language. So they started to listen to that. And all of a sudden, in a few years, they went back to market leader. What they teach us was an inspiration to actually create the Hyperloop. So what is the Hyperloop? Because a lot of people doesn't know what the Hyperloop is. Imagine to have a capsule with 28 people. You put this capsule inside the tube, you evacuate the tube from the air, so there's no resistance. It's like being on space inside the tube. Now, because there's no friction, you can move this capsule at almost the speed of sound with very few energy. And that's amazing. Why? Why it's so amazing? And why we haven't done it before? It's amazing because it's basically using very few energy, so you can build a system that actually can make money. There's nothing on the ground that makes money right now. It's incredible. A lot of people doesn't know it. Every single system, undergrounds, high-speed rail, they're all subsidized by the state. So our tax money, it's subsidizing it.
That's right.
This is broken in so many ways. And, you know, we are, you know, continuously building our infrastructure, trying to solve one problem, and we create another 10, you know? Mm-hmm. If you look at what's happening in traffic right now, we are stuck in traffic for hours. If I would tell you, tomorrow is the last day of your life, you would be pissed, right? You would be disappointed.
Well, if it's the truth, I'll be taking quick action to do stuff.
Quick action, but you will be starting all the things that you haven't done, the people that you haven't loved, and you want to embrace your family. It's a very tough moment for you. Well, if you live in Kuala Lumpur, if you live in Beijing, in Shanghai, in Milan, in all the major cities of the world, you're losing years of life.
Because of traffic jams.
Yeah. Because of traffic, while you're breathing, and they're not stealing your life all of a sudden, no.
It's just little by little.
A little piece every day, half an hour here, 20 minutes there, and we're becoming numb. So this has to be changed. The Hyperloop, it's a system that is the genius of what we are creating, and we are the only company that actually has this amazing solution, is that we're using a solution that is passive levitation. Imagine, you know how magnets work, right? Plus and minus create they repel each other.
Yeah.
If you do plus and minus, you create an attraction, yes. Right? And these were the classical way to build magnets. There was a north and a south, plus and minus. We are capable of rewriting in a surface of a magnet several magnetic fields to allow electrons to move in a different way. And this can generate a magnet that, if it's static, it doesn't do anything. But if you move it, it can generate a passive levitation that becomes more stable the faster it goes.
Amazing.
So in the first 20 miles speed acceleration, you will have a car, basically, that can travel in a laminate of aluminium without any electricity on the track. But as soon as you pass that speed, it will automatically levitate without using any electricity.
Amazing.
And that's combined with the propulsion system, that it's a linear motor, creates the most efficient system on the ground.
Amazing. We're just out of time for this segment, okay. So we're going to take a quick break. We're going to come back here with Bibop to finish the final segment here on the Leaderonomics Show.
Stay tuned.
Welcome back to the Leaderonomics Show. I'm with Bibop Gresta, and we are talking about Hyperloops and all these exciting technology advances. And you know, I'm curious. Disruption is everywhere, right? What's your take on disruption, and what do you think? Is it something that we need to continue to push for? Or, because a lot of people advocate, why can't we just keep the world as it is?
Well, it's impossible. Change happens if you want it or not. We are evolutionary animals, so we need to evolve. I think we are in a very important phase of humanity. We are passing from a Homo sapiens to what I call Homo evolutus. So we are.
Did I get Homo?
Homo evolutus.
Okay.
And the reason is that the humanity now can actually intervene into the deep root of what we are, like, you know, modifying our genome, extending our lifespan. I hope singularity will never happen, but I'm a super fan. Singularity is when the computer take over.
Yep.
But I'm a super fan of transhumanism,
okay.
To use technology to improve ourselves. And it's happening at a pace that we were not even imagining. Now, that is good. And we need to have people that dedicate their life on the important topic of humanity. Now, kids, I know you all like to go and develop the next Facebook for cats or Uber for plants, but there's also big problems to solve. This planet will be gone if we don't act fast on the basic topics. And we have the technology to actually build a better world based not on consumption and all this, you know, craziness about building a planet of unlimited resources. Sorry, we built an economy of unlimited resources in a planet that has limited resources. Yep. This is stupidity. Yep. Our children will look at us in 50 years and say, really, Dad? Did you do that? We did, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. But the basic conception of work will change. I mean, 40% of the total work that we conceive will be gone in 50 years and will not be replaced because, you know, the computer will take over. And this is good. We need to start to think at a different economy based on happiness and not on, you know, stupidity and greed and all this.
Yeah. But it's very hard, right? It's very systemic, right?
I don't think it's hard. I traveled in more than 50 countries in the last 8 months, and I've seen that the new generation are better than us. and they do care. And I strongly believe there is a parallel cross-generation that is growing that can change everything. And the funny thing, and these political people are not seeing it coming, so it's even better, okay? What we will be assisting in the American election will be the ultimate show of what is wrong in this, you know.
Although we are both 16, so you know we are part of this right. generation,
well,
right?
Well, I'm going into the 17. I've
yeah,
told
yeah, okay. So you're slightly older than me.
Yeah, slightly older, but I could vote. I could very soon. But thank you very much. We'll pay you for that. But I think you know the advice that I can give to people that are of that generation, yeah. like you know, you're doing school, is not to focus. And I know they
not to focus. Not
no,
to focus.
Don't focus, guys. Don't focus.
Instead of focus, do.
So, at the beginning of your career, and up to you know when you're initially approaching the market, or even when you're studying, try different things. If you think you are understood something, change. Insert novelty in your knowledge, and focus will be the wrong thing to do, because right now to innovate you need to see and contaminate every single topic with different things. Mm. So first advice,
okay.
Don't focus. The second advice is be strange.
Be strange.
Yes.
Okay.
So in a, I don't know if you're familiar with the concept of the blue ocean and red ocean, right?
Yes.
Create your blue ocean and do it in an original way. I'm not saying do tattoos in your face, and I'm not talking about physical appearance. I'm talking try to differentiate yourself. And if they say you're strange, you're in a good direction.
So if people say you're strange, means you're all right.
Yes.
In your books.
Yes.
All
in
right.
my view, you have to be strange.
Okay.
And you know, that's important.
So those are the advice that you would give someone who's just starting out in life?
Yes.
Okay. Any other pieces that you think it's important for a young person to
I think,
be wary of?
You know, the most important thing is never give up. You need to fail, and failure is a norm. I know that it's very cliche, but I will add something to this, okay? A lot of time you feel lonely, because, you know, when you start a path that is different, you will for sure get the opposition of the people that doesn't understand
this. Sure, even from Galileo's time, right?
But there's a very old Chinese proverb that says, you know, whom who say it cannot be done does not have to be on the way of the people that are doing it. So always distance from the people try to stop you,
okay.
And be stubborn. That's the only way to achieve what you want. At the beginning of our journey on the Hyperloop, everybody was saying that we were crazy. And I was crazy. I put all my money and what I am. I always all in. I put everything in the Hyperloop. And right now we have almost $500 million valuation on a company that didn't even start to raise money. So we have almost $80 million in donation and assets without even going to a VC. And can you imagine this before we even started this journey? And they're contributing with lands and engineering and tools to make this happen. I think this is the most fantastic journey of my life. And I'm so eager right now that we are starting to build the first Hyperloop. I'm so eager to see it coming to fruition.
Yeah, and I, you know, I think you're right. I mean, if you're stubborn, it's where innovation is. I mean, you look at all the great innovators; they've always been stubborn with the idea and the concept, and something happens. So I'm sure it will happen to you too. You know?
Yes.
my final question before I make you wrap is, you know, if you meet a group of CEOs, right, a bunch of leaders of companies, and you had a chance to address them and say, hey, here's my advice to you, what sort of pearls of wisdom or what sort of insights would you give to a group of leaders?
So this society creates memes. Right now, we are treated like rock stars. And this is good. if I think about the rock star of my age, they were really bad role models.
Drugs.
You don't want to do that, okay? But I've seen the new generation changing. Right now, we have a big responsibility to this young generation because they get inspired by us and they get really, you know, they want to be us, and this is good. But we also have to carry the responsibility and not to believe that it's about us. It's about the team and the improvement that we can give to humanity. And this is the most important thing. So if you put economy or revenues in front, it will be, your company will be disrupted by something else, because right now it's not about money. And the past taught us a lot of lessons. For example, one of the lessons, if something it's not good for you, for the people that surround you, or for the earth in general, you shouldn't do it. It's as simple as that. It's nature is simple, and we need to apply the principles of nature applied to our economy right now. So that's super important, and the leader of tomorrow needs to carry this as their basic principle.
Sure. And they must have the courage to enable this to happen.
But you know the funny thing? It's, yeah, you need to have a courage at the beginning, but then it becomes the norm and it's profitable. Mm. All of a sudden you discover that it's more profitable not to good, yeah. continue to pollute, yeah, but absolutely. To respect the people, because the money that we have to spend and then to fix it, it's way superior. So economy is simple and our planet has to embrace it.
Sure. It's been fantastic speaking to you here. You're here in KL to speak at the TEDx Kuala Lumpur, right?
Yes, and to speak also to your politician,
oh, really?
To investor. We have a lot of meeting in schedule. We will try to implement an Hyperloop in this country very soon. We're looking at different routes.
That sounds very exciting.
Yeah, and I think, you know, going from Kuala Lumpur to Singapore in 17 minutes can change forever this country, and I look forward to achieve this in the next few years.
Fantastic, you know, we really look forward to it. Now, remember you promised us that you were going to rap for us, right?
So I didn't promise.
Well, you know, when you say it on TV, it's automatically assumed it's a promise. So,
okay, but I'm sorry, but I don't have music.
Well,
so
we'll get music, right? So can we get some beats out here?
You're actually prepared.
Yeah.
That was an ambush.
Yeah.
Okay, so you.
All right. So do you need to stand
okay,
up?
Okay.
You need
okay.
To...
So what the camera?
Which camera?
Which camera do you want? This one.
All right.
One. Okay. 1 2 1 2. Okay. I rap in Italian.
Yeah, anytime, yeah.
Okay.
In whatever language, right?
Okay. No alla violenza. No alla violenza. No. Io non ci casco, non ci sto a questo gioco losco, io me ne sbatto delle tue cagate già sentite date amplificate. Ma le case sono volute perché abbiamo forte in faccia, carica solo la voce gente taccia e acconsenta, mo mi faccia il piacere di far notare che sono vocabolario a quanto buon otto, no alla violenza, dopo se mi scappano mi preoccupa.
Well done. Bibop,
you did.
Thank you so much for being here on our show, and it's been the most memorable and pleasurable time.
Oh,
there,
wow.
You know? And we look forward to seeing Hyperloops all over the world, and great success to you in all your ventures.
It has been a pleasure.
Thank you again.
See you then.
We've been here on the Leaderonomics Show with Bibop Gresta.